444, please. 444.
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to
number 280. After the service, you folks that are members and all will know why we're singing this one. After the service. Amen. Let's see. Can we do it here?
Oh, my brother, do you know the Savior who is wondrous, kind, and true? He's the rock. Rock for body in the rock for you. Do you pray unto God the Father? One will no heavy to do. Never fear, he will surely answer. There is honey in the rock for you. Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sins for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. Then go out through the streets and byways. Preach the word to the many or the few. Say to every fallen brother, there's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sins for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.
We need to teach the new people. We need to sing it for them again. Ready? Let's do it again. Here we go.
Be a missionary every day. Tell the world that Jesus is the way. Be it in the town or country or a busy avenue. Hey! Africa or Asia, the task is up to you. So be a missionary every day. Tell the world that Jesus is the way. The Lord is soon returning. There is no time to lose. So be a missionary, God's own emissary. Be a missionary today. Let's go!
If you'd all join me in honoring God's word, we'll be reading from Luke chapter 18, verses 35 through 43. So if you join me and stand with me this morning. And God's word says, "And it came to pass that he was come nigh unto Jericho. A certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. And he cried, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they which went before rebuked him, that he should hold his peace. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought unto him. And when he was come near, he asked him, saying, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? And he said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, receive thy sight, thy faith has saved thee.
Amen.
And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you that you're able to give sight through Jesus Christ, that in so many ways he's healed the blind that could not see in the darkness. And we thank you, Lord, that you sent a great light into the world in Jesus Christ, and that through Jesus Christ the blind can see the truth of God. And we just praise you, Lord, this morning that we have thy very words to look upon this morning, and that they reveal more of thy light to us. And may we go out into this world today with the light of Jesus Christ and in full sight, and seeing you, Lord, in every place in your creation. And we just ask, Lord, that you would live more through us and impart more of thy light within us, that we may continue to shine in the darkness in this world. And we pray the anointing power of the Holy Spirit upon the pastor this morning to preach the light of thy word to us this morning. Open our hearts, Lord, to the wisdom of thy words, that we may receive it in truth, and clear our minds, Lord, that you may saturate us with thy word. And we just praise you and thank you, Lord Jesus. And in thy precious name we pray. Amen.
This Sunday 40 years ago was December 16th. And just tomorrow will be the 16th. And 40 years ago on that Sunday, I asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior.
Amen.
What a difference. What a change it made in my life.
Mm.
And I was blind, now I see. Amen. That's what I've titled my message this morning. And I want us to think about the fact that all over this world there are millions of blind, spiritually blind people that, you know, that now Satan has in their in his power. And he wants to keep them that way. He holds them in that blindness. And he wants men and women, boys and girls, all over, never to see the real truth, never to see the real gift of God in Jesus Christ. And this time of year, we're thinking about all the gifts and that kind of thing. The gift, the unspeakable gift, is the Lord Jesus Christ and his
Amen.
Salvation. I mean, there's nothing better that anybody can receive than that. And we're looking at this man, this blind man that we have here. And you know that in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 through 6, God's word tells us there, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse, I'm sorry, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 through 6, it says this, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. And a Baptist church isn't going to get anybody saved, amen. Neither is any other kind of church going to get anybody saved.
That's right.
Amen? But the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the one who'll get people to heaven. He's the one who can forgive their sins. He's the one who paid for their sin at Calvary's cross. And we have to keep that in mind. But God of this world, that's what Satan is called. He's blinded their eyes all around. People that you see, oh, they might look happy and that, but they're blinded. They really are blinded. The man in our passage was physically blind, but he also was spiritually blind. But he came to know Jesus Christ as Savior.
Amen.
And that's a great thing. He had his spiritual eyes open to Jesus before his physical eyes were touched at all. And I'll bring that out as we go through it. Now, our passage that we have here in Luke and the passages in Matthew and Mark make people say that the Bible has errors. And the only way you're going to understand that is for us to take a look. So go with me to Matthew, if you would, chapter 20. Matthew chapter 20, and look there with me, verse 30 through 34. Matthew chapter 20, verse 30 through 34. We have written here, "And behold, two men sitting by the wayside, when they heard that Jesus passed by, cried out, saying, Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou Son of David. And the multitude rebuked them, because they should hold their peace. But they cried the more, saying, Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou Son of David. And Jesus stood still, and called them, and said, What will ye that I shall do unto you? They say unto him, Lord, that our eyes may be opened. So Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him." So this passage says two, and it uses the plural pronouns, you know, they and that sort of thing quite often here. And so the people that want to criticize the Bible say there's an error. There are two here, there's only one in Luke. Now if you go to Mark's passage, if you would, in Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 52, Mark chapter 10, verse 46 through 52, you hear a little bit more about all this. And we see this in Mark chapter 10, verse 46. It says, "And they came to Jericho. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging." And by the way, bar is the word for son in Hebrew. And so he's the son of Timaeus and bar. And so the Jewish people have what's called a bar mitzvah, you know, where the boy now becomes a son of Abraham. He becomes part of the sonship of all of that. And so they have a bar mitzvah for him. Jesus talked about Peter. He called him Simon bar Jonah, you know, the son of Jonah. That's what bar in Hebrew means. So verse 37, "And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, Thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, Be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus." You know, that old garment, an old rag that he had. You know, the Bible says about all our good works, they're just filthy rags.
That's right.
You know, and I've seen beggars that wear filthy rags just so they get more money.
Yep.
That's a trick they do. You know, I mean, you know, maybe he made good money, but he wasn't going to let people know that or they wouldn't give to him. Amen? But he threw off his garments in a picture of us throwing off all our good works. But he came to Jesus, and Jesus, verse 51, answered and said unto him, What wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. So do we have a conflict? And I know immediately anyone who knows the Word of God will say, No, there's never a conflict in the Word of God. Two men in Matthew and one in Mark and one in Luke. Not a conflict. Now remember, Matthew's writing about Jesus Christ as the King of the Jews. And by the way, kings count everything. You know, when it comes to census, they want to count everything. When it comes to taxes, they want to count everything. I believe there were two men blind. But then what we read in Mark, it tells us there about this man named Bartimaeus. And as I've studied Scripture these, 40 years, I've seen that whenever somebody joined up with the church and was an active part of the church, their name gets put into the Word of God. Mm. And they're called by their name. And we've got Bartimaeus and we've got Timaeus. So I think when he received his sight, that eventually his father, Timaeus, trusted Christ also as wow. Savior, and that the two of them were active in the church. Mm. Now, you and I give out gospel tracts. We carry them around with us. We give them out. We give them out all the time. You know, Dave was trying to give them out as many people as he could there yesterday at the reception and all. We give out gospel tracts. Well, we don't know everybody out there to get saved.
That's right.
But if they come and join our church, you become part of our church, then we know them by name. We write that down, that they're the ones. And so what I believe here is that Luke was able, as the physician, he was able to talk to Bartimaeus. And because of that, all he wrote about was the one. But the king counted the two. They both came and followed Christ. But we know that later on in Christ's ministry, when Jesus said some hard things, that some of the disciples stopped following him. And perhaps that's what happened with that one other blind man. He just went on his way. There's not conflicts in the Bible. There's not contradictions in the Bible. When you study it out, you understand what the Bible's got to say. And so we're looking here then in Luke, as we're studying through the book of Luke, verse by verse, we're looking then at this one named in Jericho named Bartimaeus, and he's begging and begging, you know, he needs something. And that's important for us to understand, that he needs something. Because this man had his heart overjoyed because he had hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, we need hope often. Folks, we need to have hope. Hope that God, through Jesus Christ, is going to do some great things. And if you're here today looking in by way of the internet, you're lost, you need hope that Jesus Christ is passing by and that he'll see you. Hope for the lost, hope for our own very needs, you know. And we see Jesus, and in verse 37 it says, And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. Jesus is passing by you today. He's come by. If you're viewing by way of the internet, it's an opportunity. Jesus is passing by you today. And you can have that same hope. You know, and the thing is, if somebody's passing by, they don't linger. There's only an hour that he passes by, only a time that he passes by.
That's right.
You know, Jesus offers salvation to all mankind, but he doesn't stay there and linger. If they refuse that salvation, he goes on. There's somebody else that'll trust Christ as Savior.
Amen.
So here Jesus is. He's passing by. And I want you to see what the blind man saw. All right? I got C in quotation marks because he's blind, but he saw some things. First of all, he saw the need of salvation, verse 35 through 38. He saw the need of salvation. This blind man had to beg to get his money to live by. And you know, lost people think that this world is all that they need to get by with. But I really don't know how they do it, and a lot of them don't do it. Isn't that true? A lot of them give up and just, they commit suicide, they kill themselves because they can't get through. But they think that this world is all they need. Now, this blind people, you know, a lot of blind people have a lot of gifts. It's amazing. You know, someone who's blind can hear, incredible, can smell, feel things. You know, blind people sometimes are not distracted by some things and are able to do some things that other people can't. One real good example is all we have to do is just open up our hymn book and look in there, page after page after page that has Fanny Crosby's name. Blind. She had something wrong with her eyes. They put something in that didn't know whether it would work or not. I don't remember exactly what they did, but it blinded her, you know. And they offered her, believe it or not, they offered her a surgery that would fix her eyes. She said, "No thanks. When I open my eyes, the first one I want to see is Jesus."
Wow.
Wow. It's just incredible, amen? You know, just incredible. So, you know, he had incredible hearing. And he's sitting there begging day after day, day after day, day after day. And, you know, people are walking by and they're walking this way and they're walking that way. And as they're walking, he hears them talk about, you know, there's this Jesus of Nazareth. He's got to be the Christ. He's got to be the Messiah, the one we've been looking for. He does all kinds of miracles. Why, he made the lame to walk, and he made a deaf man and who couldn't speak, made him to hear and to talk. And, you know, he's raised the dead, and he's made blind people to, and he's hearing that as the multitudes are going by. You know, he's sitting in a place where there's lots and lots of people going by so he can get more money. And yet, through all that din, all that clamor and noise and all that's going on with it, and the animals' noises and people and all those kinds of things, you know, he keeps hearing about Jesus, hearing about Jesus. And now there's a multitude passing by here. Verse 36, and hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. What's this tumult? This is different. This sounds different than the normal coming through. What is this? Of course, verse 37, and they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passed by. Oh, wow, wow. Isn't it something? He had no skepticism. You know, he wasn't skeptic. Here he is. You know, he's blind. You know, but he's not saying, "Well, I'm not so sure about this one. I don't know if I can trust this one." He heard it was Jesus, and right away cries out for Jesus. He wants Jesus to do something for him right away. He's not, you know, going to try to analyze it and all that kind of thing that people do today.
That's right.
You know. And isn't it something that the people said it's Jesus of Nazareth? And yet in verse 38, and he cried saying, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." You know, people had it mixed up that Jesus was from Nazareth when he really was born in Bethlehem. You know? Being born in Bethlehem, I mean, that takes us all the way back to the birth, what we're thinking about this time of year, the birth of Jesus Christ, that because he was of the house and lineage of David, Joseph had to go to Bethlehem to be taxed, and so the baby was born there because the baby is of that royal line of David. Mm-hmm. And the blind man could see that. He's not seeing him as Jesus of Nazareth, just a man. He's seeing him as Jesus, the Son of David, the sent one, the Messiah, the God in the flesh. And he's just so excited about it. "Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me." I mean, he'd heard people talking about Jesus being the Messiah. And he cried, you know, and of course this is a form of prayer here. "Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me." That's what lost people all around the world need to do. Cry out for Jesus to have mercy on them. You remember there, you know, in Matthew chapter 1, in that story about the birth of Jesus, in Matthew chapter 1, if you'd look at verse 21, remember the angel is talking to Joseph about this baby that's inside Mary's womb. And he said to him, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Jesus means Savior.
Amen.
You know, and that's what we see there. And then you go to Luke chapter 2, if you would. In the, again, we're looking here at that birth of Jesus Christ. And in Luke chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, we see here, "And the angel said unto them, Fear not." Remember the shepherds are keeping their flocks by night there. And he says to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord."
Yes, sir.
A Savior. You know, not just another baby. That baby's right. Born every day. Mm. Yeah. But a Savior born. Wow. The Son of David, the King, the Messiah that's supposed to be. Have mercy on me. Not heal me. Isn't that something?
Yeah.
He cries out, "Have mercy on me." Mm. And he doesn't say anything about heal me. "Have mercy on me, for I have I've sinned against you. Have mercy on me." You know, here in chapter 18 of Luke, just a couple verses back from where we were, just a few messages back, we looked at the parable there that Jesus talked about, the two men that went into the temple, the one a Pharisee, the other a publican. And there at verse 13 of chapter 18 of Luke, "And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner." He just says, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I'm the one that sinned against you. I can't even get close to you, God. God, be merciful to me, a sinner." What a plea for salvation. That's what people have to do. They don't realize that they need to cry out and admit their sin. And here's blind Bartimaeus. "Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me." But I want you also this morning to see the hindrance to salvation, verse 39 and 40. Here this blind man is crying out. And verse 39 says, "And they which went before rebuked him that he should hold his peace." You know, there's all kinds of people in all kinds of ways that hinder lost people from coming to know Christ as Savior. That do anything they can. No, you don't want to be saved. You want to, no, don't you know if you trust Jesus Christ, you're saved, you're going to have to give up this and give up that, and it's going to be bad for you, and your family's going to hate you. And that, I mean, they do anything they can. Hey, we got to go out and party. Isn't it amazing? You know, when you're trying to talk to somebody, you're showing them from the Word of God that they're lost, that they need Jesus Christ as Savior, and you're showing them from the Word of God, and Satan will have one of their buddies call on the phone. One of their friends will come walking in just then.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
They'll hinder that person from getting saved. I'm telling on Jeannie's family. She had an uncle at a church service want to get saved. He stood up to go walk down the aisle to go front, trust Christ as his Savior. And his wife grabbed a hold of him, pulled him down, sat him down, said, "You're not going forward." Mm-hmm. Hindrance. You know, sometimes we can be a hindrance to somebody getting saved. The message is done and we're closing up our Bible and zipping it and getting our things and all that and being a distraction. And somebody is there, "I need to ask Jesus to be my Savior." "Oh, well, I guess it's time to go. We got to go." Mm. got to be careful about being a hindrance. They rebuked him. Hey, it's fine. You want to cry out and ask for money? Fine. You just go ahead, beg for money. Alms for the poor, alms for the poor, alms. Go ahead. But don't you be crying out for Jesus. We don't want any of that. We don't want that kind of thing to happen. Isn't that pathetic?
Yes.
That people would stop a man from trying to trust Jesus as their Savior. Mm-hmm. It's just an incredible thing when you think about that. They told him, hold your peace. Keep quiet. Always somebody, you know, guided by Satan to hold back a seeking sinner mm-hmm. that wants to come to Jesus Christ. But I'm thrilled there at verse 39, but he cried so much the more. Thou son of David, have mercy on me. He was going to let somebody stop him. If you don't know Jesus Christ as Savior, please, please don't let anybody stop you.
That's right.
You just come right to Jesus. Come Amen. To him. Amen. And don't let anyone stop you. And he cried out to Jesus. And Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought unto him. And when he was come near, he asked him. That crying out made Jesus stop. He was passing by. Just passing by. He was on his way for something. But when he cried out like that, Jesus stopped. Jesus stood, stopped walking, commanded him to be brought unto him. If we'll cry out that way, amen, after the blind cried so much the more. Is someone holding you back from something, some fear holding you back, cry the more. If you don't know Jesus as Savior, cry the more. Instead of Jesus passing by, let him stop and be brought to him that you might know salvation. But thirdly, let me go on, the proof of salvation. We've looked at the need of salvation. We've looked at the hindrance to salvation, the proof of salvation, verse 41 to 43. I talked to us a little bit earlier when we were there in Mark chapter 10. Remember at verse 50, he set aside his garment. So Jesus has stopped and commanded him to be brought to him. Remember, he's blind. He needs somebody to guide him to him. And when he gets up, he throws off that garment, that picture of all of our poor self-effort, all of our own works that are filthy rags, won't do anything for us. We're not saved by our works, we're saved by grace. Amen. That's what we're saved by grace and grace alone. And so he gets up and he comes. And Jesus asks him at verse 41, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? That's what he asks him. What wilt thou? And you notice how he answers here in verse 41 of Luke 18. And he said, Lord. Now, folks, don't just go over quick over words. The Holy Spirit picked words perfectly. He picked certain words for a reason. If this man, the first thing out of his mouth face to face with Jesus Christ is Lord, he's saying, I trust you as my Savior.
Amen. Yes.
I mean, he could have called him Rabbi. He could have called him Master. Could have called him Teacher. He couldn't have not worried anything. He just could have said, I want to see. Fix my eyes. I'm blind. He could have been smart aleck and said, hey, you know, obviously, don't you think I need to be healed here of my blindness? You know? But no, the first thing out of his mouth is Lord. You know, that's the same thing with Paul on his way to Damascus.
Wow.
You know, he's Saul of Tarsus at that point. And he's got letters to go and arrest as many Christians as he can. And if he has to, he'll execute a few here and there. He doesn't care. He's going to just try to get rid of this sect. He's trying to get rid of those in the way of Jesus. And on the road, you know, Jesus appears to him and he falls down. And the first thing that he says to him is, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? There was a change there. Something happened that he went from being Jesus, who he's after and hates, to being Lord.
Amen.
And there's a change. And it's the same thing for this blind man. There's a change. But of course, he's been crying out for Jesus, Savior, the Son of David, Messiah, the King that's supposed to come. That's who he's been crying out to, not Jesus of Nazareth. And so he cries out, Lord, that I may receive my sight. That's how he started out with. He recognized him as that Messiah and Savior. And to receive is, Lord, give me a gift. Give me the gift of sight. But you know what Jesus says there, verse 42? Then Jesus said unto him, receive thy sight, thy faith hath saved thee. Mm-hmm. Now, when Jesus talks about somebody being saved, he's talking about their eternal soul, where it's going to spend eternity, heaven or hell. A lost person going to spend eternity in the lake of fire. Saved person going to spend an eternity with heaven, in heaven with Jesus Christ, with God himself.
Amen.
And he said to him, thy faith hath saved thee. You see, he had faith when he called him Lord. He had faith when he called him Son of David and have mercy on me. He didn't cry out, Son of David, heal my blindness. Have mercy on me. I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. That's what he was saying with all of that. And so he did receive that gift right away. But the proof is that he was saved. And the proof is that Jesus Christ told him, thy faith hath saved thee. You know, there's some people that struggle with their salvation. You know, some days they think, well, I did that sin, I must not be saved. And, you know, they've got no proof. You know, sometimes when I tell people that I asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior on December 16th, 1973, about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they go, wow, that's kind of too specific. You know, well, for me, it was that traumatic a thing. I mean, just that incredible a thing that I remembered it. I mean, it just changed my life so completely, that load of sin that I had been carrying off me. I mean, I just had joy. I had just such peace. I mean, it was just incredible. And I understood why Jesus came. You know, I mean, it's this time of year. You know, everybody's thinking about Christmas. Ah, Jesus came because he's going to be my Savior. Oh, wow. So it really embedded in me that particular time that I asked Jesus to be my Savior. Some other people, they can't remember. They don't know. They know they did, but they don't. So sometimes Satan comes along and gives them doubts about their salvation. But the proof is the Word of God. I didn't get saved because it was December 16th. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
That's not why I got saved. I got saved because the Word of God said, whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that's what I did. On that day, I cried out just like this man. You know, Jesus, thou Son of David, be merciful to me, a sinner. I mean, I cried out to him that particular Sunday. And so here's this man. He's got the proof. Jesus said to him, thy faith hath saved thee. Have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? If you have, your faith has saved you. Not your works, nothing else. Not being healed of some disease, that doesn't save you. I had a woman tell me one time that she knew she was saved because she had lost her husband's camera and it turned up in the house and is an expensive camera and that's how she knew she was saved. I thought, huh? You know, what if somebody comes along, lady, and tells you, well, I found the camera and I brought it to the house. You know, that's not any miracle of God. You know what I mean? I'm not going to hang on to a miracle. I'm going to hang on to the Word of God that'll never fade, never pass away, never change. That's what I'm going to hang on to. Amen. And that's what he was able to hang on. Thy faith has saved thee. And you notice that after Jesus says, thy faith hath saved thee, verse 43, we get to, and immediately he received his sight. He didn't get his sight when Jesus said, receive thy sight. Jesus went on to say, "Thy faith hath saved thee," and then immediately he received his sight. He had the faith first and then the sight. It's amazing to me. There's a lot of television evangelists that want to heal people and have no idea whether they're saved or not. You know, I don't understand that. You know, they need to be saved, and then if they have something, God can heal and heals them, fine, praise God for it. But all they want is the glory of being thought of as the healer. Yeah, they want that glory. Yeah, get them saved. God will work out the other parts. He'll either take the problem away, or he'll give them the grace to go through life with that problem. So, yeah, just, you didn't pay for that, but I threw it in there. Amen? There was salvation before a physical touch. And then he followed Jesus, and that was his proof that he had trusted Jesus as Savior. He received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. Now, you know, with the other two that we read before, it only said they followed him. It didn't say anything about them glorifying God. And that's why I wonder if that one went away and so he wasn't counted with the church. Didn't get the name written down as Bartimaeus did and his father Timaeus. He glorified God, and it said, and all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God. You know, when we let Jesus do something in our life, other people praise God for it. When we glorify God, when we get up and say, "I'm thankful Jesus saved me."
Amen.
Other people glorify God. You know, we sing about, one of the songs we sing, I love to tell the story, you know, and I love to tell it for those who already know, already have heard it, you know, because it still thrills us.
Amen.
To know that we trust Christ as Savior and that God did an incredible work in our life. I mean, it's just great. Amen? Just great. What God did for me, I just can't believe it. I can't believe it. You know, I'll be in heaven and say, "Jesus, why'd you save me?" And then before he gets the answer, I'd say, "And why'd you call me to be in the pastor? Why'd you put me here?" I'll never understand that. Never, ever will I understand that. Let me conclude. Jesus is passing by today, passing by you. He'll only stop for a moment and call you to come to him if you cry out for his mercy. Those that are lost, oh, please, cry out for his mercy. Will you remain in your spiritual blindness, or will you cry as blind Bartimaeus did? Afterward, Bartimaeus would be able to say, "I was blind, now I see." We sang Amazing Grace. "Saved a wretch like me," that's me. "Wretch hardly describes me, as sinful as I was." "I once was blind, but now I see. I praise God for it."
Amen.
He's passing by, and that means he'll be gone soon. What will you do with Jesus? Let's bow our heads. And if there's someone that doesn't know Jesus as Savior, today can be the day of salvation. You that are listening in by way of the internet, please, where you are right now, be honest before God. Admit before God, "Yes, God, I'm a sinner. Those times that I've used your name as a swear word, that's sin. Those times I disobeyed my parents, that's sin. Those times that I lied, that's sin. Those times that I looked on someone of the opposite sex and lusted after them, that's sin. Those times that I got angry when I shouldn't have. Those times that I was jealous and envious and coveted after things and after what other people have and all, that's sin. I'm sorry for my sin. Oh, please, please, dear Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus, thou Son of David, Lord Jesus Christ, please be my Savior today. I cry out right now, be merciful to me. Come into my heart and life, Jesus, and be my Savior, master of my life. Then hear Jesus say, thy faith hath saved thee. If you put your faith in him, he'll save you today. Those of us that know Jesus as Savior, have you got assurance of your salvation? Do you understand that the Word of God is what you can hang on to? A verse of Scripture. So that when Satan comes along and tells you, oh, you're not a Christian, to think that, to do that, to say that, you can't be a Christian. You say, wait a minute, yes. God's Word said, whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God's word said, as many as believed on him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. The word of God says it. Are you about the business of helping the blind to see? Are you part of the hinderers? Father, I come to you and I thank you again for your word. I thank you and praise you that 40 years ago, you and your grace and mercy, your love and your kindness, reached down to me, let me see that I needed Jesus as my Savior. Lord, please, help Raph's dad, our grandfather rather, on the, and his dad too, but help his grandfather on that deathbed all these years trying to mingle Christianity with Islam. May he, as he thinks about all these things, by the power of thy Holy Spirit, understand that Jesus Christ can only be his hope. That Allah and the writings of Muhammad do him no good, for they did nothing for him. But Jesus died on the cross for him. Not only for him, but for every man, woman, and child, that if they'd trust him, he'd apply that shed blood to their account and wash away their sins. Oh Lord, please, may there be some that though their sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I want us to stand and sing, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Jesus passed by those people that day. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. Number 293, let's stand together. 293 in your hymn book. And as we sing, if there's anyone here that needs to see from the Word of God how you can be saved today, we'd love to show you from the Bible.
Amen.
It's what it will save a person today. Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at a throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble thou art calling, do not pass me by.
This one's written by Fanny Crosby. I wonder if she wrote this after reading that passage of Scripture.
Mm-hmm.
Blind, hearing about that, someone reading to her the words of God, or her doing with Braille, feeling and reading the words of God about this blind man and that Jesus passed by.
Mm-hmm.
Wonder if that's the passage that inspired her to write this. Trusting only in thy merit, would I seek thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit. Save me by thy grace.
Amen.
Let's sing that fourth stanza.
Thou, the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me. Whom have I on earth beside thee? Whom in heaven but thee? Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, hear not pass me by.
Amen. Emmanuel, would you close us in a word of prayer, please?
As well, Father, I would want to say a very big thank you to you. Thank you for your word that has come for us this morning. You've asked us a very big question. What we will do with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Heavenly Father, the grace to surrender all to you, to give our life and our hope, and everything inside of us, Father, release unto us in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, the grace to appropriate all that Christ has done for us on the cross of Calvary.
Yes.
The grace to recognize you as our Lord, as our Savior, as our Messiah, as our Redeemer. That grace, Lord, release unto us. Help us to accept you as our Lord and our Savior. Help us not to allow you to just pass by without you making an impact in our lives. Heavenly Lord, we ask that even as we depart, cannot depart out of your presence. We ask that your presence will always be with us. We ask that your presence, O Lord, will always make us to be what you really want us to be. Father, we thank you because we know indeed you've answered. For in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks.
Amen. 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 Thank you, folks. This afternoon, another message. And of course, Wednesday night, we'll be meeting here. And those of you that are members here, we have a Merry Christmas present for you.